Welcome to the Matrix with your boy, Prime Style. Let's get it. Now, before we start, what I would like for everyone to do, I'd like for y'all to subscribe to my channel. And once you subscribe, you're going to see this Taco Bell sign here. I need for you to click that Taco Bell sign. And what that enables you to do is you will get emails and notifications on your cell phone and in your email to let you know when I upload my videos and all my content, and you will never miss a beat. So let's go ahead and get to the video. What's up, everybody, and thanks for dropping in for another segment of The Matrix in the vault with your boy Prime. And what do you have here? You have NBA Elite 11. This is the final installment on the last gen, the Xbox 360 and the PlayStation 3. Now, we all know what actually happened with NBA Elite 11 moving forward, but I want to bring forth this because this is still a part of the NBA Live series that is still relevant, even though the game was not released. So I'm going to present a lot of things a lot of people might have never seen and didn't break down to explain a little bit more about NBA Elite 11, because they did incorporate a lot of great things in this title. So moving forward, and even though this was the start of the debacle process because they canceled NBA Elite 11 because a lot of, you know, reasons or influences. So I'm going to just showcase and break down everything for everyone. So when you first boot up the game and when you start up, you're going to have to create a player. And as you see in the background, there are a lot of things that were from NBA Live 10 that they did transition over. As you see in the background, that is the hangar. Now you create this player. Now in this title, they emphasized a lot on transitioning incorporating the my player aspect of how they wanted to do it. And where you had to go into, you know, where you could rank up and do certain things, you know, in this title. And the direction that they wanted to go, you know, was very, very interesting and intriguing with that. But before I go back to that, you're probably going to hear my brain in the background. But the first thing that I want to bring forth was that, which was actually something that they wanted to do. They want to differentiate with the controls, as you see. Now, what I want everybody to do and look at and really, really pay attention as I do this, because I'm going to be on this control portion for a moment of time in this video. So I want you to look at the when I'm dribbling with my player, and also I want you to pay attention to the meters on the left and the right and how they supposed to coordinate how the dribble mechanics was supposed to be. Now, what they wanted to do with the franchise moving forward, I'm not going to get into everything on the reason why they wanted to change the name. And, you know what? I will give you my speculation and my personal opinion on how I feel how they changed the name. You know what? I will dabble into that. It was EA's idea that they wanted to go into another direction with the franchise. So they wanted to change the name from NBA Live to NBA Elite, which I completely disagreed on. There were some people that went with it, and there were a lot of people that disagreed with that. And I was one of those individuals that did not agree with that. However, at the time, that was something that you had to deal with, because this was the franchise that was actually moving forward with the game. And what they wanted to incorporate was something that was different. Now, everybody says that EA wanted to copy 2K's format with the right thumbstick. Well, NBA Live already incorporated the right thumbstick with dribble mechanics. but they never incorporated it with shooting. Now remember, 2K, you have to press down to release. In NBA Elite, you had to press up. The significance in that was you had to control that jump shot on your own. It was, and I quote, "It was a great idea, however, it wasn't fully perfected." Now, when you look at these meters, you're going to see the closer you get to the basket, how that green bar is going to expand. And you see the green level on the right. Now, as I'm moving around, you're going to really see what these do. Now, you could aim your shot. The trademark to this was that, of course, the left feet, you know, the left thumbstick was your feet and the right thumbstick is your hands. That's fine. That was something that was already incorporated. But what they wanted to do was that they wanted you to control the dribbling where it wasn't mocap rendered to the point where they changed the left and right on their own. You had to do that. You had to incorporate the moves on your own to do it yourself. Now, they had basic dribble moves. Yes, they did. Now, were there other moves that were incorporated in the game? Probably so. But, you know, these were the basic dribble moves. You can go, and as you see on the screen, and what is being presented and what they wanted to do. Now, it took time to really get used to this format of control. Now, individuals that were, you know, already into the live franchise, they pretty much could get used to it, but this was the actual adjustment. The shooting and being incorporated with the right thumbstick. You had to press up and then you had to aim it. So, and their motto at that time was shooting was based upon luck. And they felt that, you know, it should have been the user controlling the jump shot to the pose of it being, you know, dice roll. Everything is already predetermined where you had no control of it. Now, don't get me wrong, in Live 10, you can control left and right layups. However, you know, you really couldn't alter it as much as you could in this. Was based upon a system by percentages that pretty much didn't pan out as much because it was manipulated. That's the word. It was manipulated by a system where you just had to press a button and they just make it, or you just shoot it at the top of your jump. What they wanted to incorporate was that you had to do everything on your own and make it. You can do a manual bank shot. And I will show you that as the video goes on in this. But you can do a manual bank shot on your own. When it came down to the layup drills, as you're going to see, it's going to be the layup drill. You had to control these on your own. It wasn't nothing that was mole captured. You had to initiate these moves by yourself. Everything was initiated. So, that was the significance in this. You had to do all this on your own. So, and again, like I said, layups, dunks, everything that was incorporated, you had to do it by yourself. Now, the only thing about NBA Elite 11 at the time was that it did still have a lot of can animations that were still in sequence with the moves, as you see here, with the falling down, with the going out, about certain things of that magnitude, because there isn't anything impeding the player to make this sudden move. So they still incorporated this in the game. And I felt that was something that they really should have had taken out, that they don't have to do. It should be, and this is where physics and where they wanted to incorporate the physics, the ragdown physics, where body and weight and strength was incorporated. Now, it was incorporated in the game, but the animations looked it very bad. And this is one thing I want to let people know, was that NBA Elite 11 was already ready to go. It was really ready to go to be shipped. It was already ready to be on the truck. EA was ready to get the game out there so everybody can have the title at that time. And if it wasn't for Hard Eight Times and that video that he had put out and the backlash that it had, this game would have been out. And also, you know, there were other things that was out there, you know, people saying bad things about it, because a lot of people didn't react to the demo extremely well because the backlash of the control mechanics was like real shocking to people. But I'll break that down in the video as I go on when it come down to the button format and the control format and the way they rearranged it and then how you can alter it. But as you're seeing here on the screen, people, is that you're seeing how I am doing all the dribble combinations and trying to bring them out to the best of my knowledge, I mean to the best of my ability, so I can get them out. And yes, it takes time. It was a real adjustment period. Some people can grasp it a little bit quicker than others. But again, this is something that they was trying to build on. And the idea was absolutely great at the time. Shout out to Connor Dugan, because he was one of the producers at the time that really, you know, pushed this and was really part of this at that time. So we would never know how NBA Elite 11 really would have been, you know, where how it would have been received if the game would have been released. Now remember, there are a lot of things that are in this game that does have NBA Live 10 in it. They just took some things out, as you see, and I'll break that down as we go along. But they did take out certain things. Now this game does have a lot of signature in the game. You will see that momentarily. But you know, there's a lot of things that they incorporate in this game. There's a lot of things that's under the hood in the game. Now, a lot of people are going to ask me, you know, this is the demo. But there was, again, like I said at the beginning of the video, there were a lot of things in this demo that people overlooked. They really didn't dive deep into it. You know, I'm going to showcase that in a second, you know, with the defense, so everybody can see that. And so you're seeing the defense right now. So the good thing about the defense was that it was this, people, is that as you're looking at my character, you can actually control the defense on which hand that you wanted to use to do a steal or, you know, play defense with. As you see, you can control it with your left or you can go with your right. You can go down to swipe the ball down to play defense. And then when you wanted to cover your guy and cut him off, it was where you can actually bite them and cut them off if you anticipate it very well on defense. And as you see, I'm going to swipe off with my hand in the way that it is. That's what they're trying to, what they want to incorporate. And then with the blocking system, you know, like I said, the animations was not fluid. They didn't have a lot of blocking animations, but you pressed up on the right thumbstick to block. And again, the things that were incorporated in NBA Elite 11 were absolutely phenomenal to me. It's just that the animation quality was very, very bad in a lot of ways. So, and when I used to play it, I used to play it a lot, you know, I was focused on the actual visual content. The visuals was a little bit died down. They took a little bit of the highlighting from Live 10 and they brought it down some, and that's why the players are dark. But the actual quality of movement and the quality of animation was absolutely unsatisfactory. It wasn't well received very well, you know. And however, things that were under the hood, such as the dribble mechanics, the things that you do on defense and so forth, and as you did, you saw, you know, things that you could do that was on defense as well. And you know, and this is the thing that, you know, they had to incorporate moving forward. But now I'm just going to do a little shoot around as I go along. So, you know, and these are for the ones that really hadn't really had a chance to really experience NBA Elite 11 and never really seen it for what it was worth, because all everybody heard was bad things about the product. It was not bad. Because, and a lot of people are going to look at stuff visually, but it was a learning curve control wise, but it was also it was an adjustment visually and what they, you know, what they watered down to an extent. Now I want people to understand is that the ESPN license was incorporated in this very, very high. The music was incorporated in this game. You had all three commentators in this game. I'm going to showcase that in this video so y'all can actually see that gameplay. And y'all will actually see it. Also, you're going to see things that what they wanted to do with the Team Jordan and, you know, their version of the My Player. And this is where that... Where a lot of people feel, and just me in general, where I felt that EA should have used the footprints, the bounce backs and leveling up format that they wanted to use in NBA Elite 11 and incorporate that in the new installments of all NBA Lives. Now, my personal opinion, I was kind of glad that NBA Elite 11 did not come out in the backlash, because right after that happened, they brought the name NBA Live back. To me, the name should have never changed, because NBA Live is a household name. It's something that was built. NBA Live was an empire, and they felt that they wanted to make a change to make a profit because NBA Live was dying. And a lot of people, it rubbed a lot of people the wrong way when they changed the name, especially a lot of veterans like myself, you know, so, and others that felt just like me. So, and that was just by the name. So we're going to go ahead and go into the actual showcase. And you actually see, as you see right now, you see Gerald Wallace. And they provided certain all-stars to let you know what was up and coming with this actual mold. And this was a good feature that they could have built on moving forward. And I still feel this is something that they should still bring forth to the table. You bring your mob, you bring your player that you create, and you bring it over, and then you build that player up. Now, this video is going to, you know, it's going to be a portion in here. So as you see, now all this stuff is going to be locked, and you're seeing all the ratings that they have placed with your player. And remember, it's still based off of the DNA for the other players for the actual NBA teams. But with your player, this is based off of how you perform. And you can't buy anything to upgrade your player. There's no money to upgrade it. You have to utterly earn your weight. As you see, you got an XP cost. It's called experience points. But you got to get these experience points. You can never buy these experience points. You had to earn this. And that was the significance of this, because you had to earn it. And then if you had a bad game in whatever area that you was bad in, you would downgrade from those points. You would get a bad grade, and those experience points would either go down, as, you know, Mark Jackson is explaining it to you.
Welcome to Become Legendary. This is the beginning of the journey that will give you the chance to earn legend status in the NBA. Your game and your career will take shape as you walk your own path through the 23 legend levels.
Every level has four requirements: grade, DNA stat levels, award points, and games played. Let's start with your grade requirement. Every game you are graded on your offense, your defense, and your team play. Each grade is given out of 10, with 10 being a perfect grade. DNA stat levels are earned by reaching thresholds in different statistical categories. Award points are given for winning championships, awards, stat titles, and completing Jordan Brand milestones. As your career progresses, you will earn experience points. The better you perform, the more XP you will earn. You can spend these points on upgrading your attributes to create your own unique legend.
There are many different paths to become a legend. This is your chance to add one more to the list. Are you ready to see if you have what it takes to become legendary?
And as this goes on, as you see, you have the T-Mobile phone, and you see this here, and you see your messages as you go along, and as everything is going through. And again, you see Joe Johnson, and he's bringing forth what it is that he's talking about it bringing forth. But again, like I said, with the Mark Jackson sequence, you understand a little bit more of what they were bringing forth to the table and what they was trying to do, and you know, with that. So, you know, the idea, you know, and I believe just with this mold alone and how much work that they put in this mold, you know, that's why a lot of things were a little bit regressed and they didn't put as much into the game as people would like. So this is just my interpretation. This is just my opinion. I'm going by what I'm seeing, because at the time I'm on the outside looking in, so I did not know. But their vision for NBA Elite, or the vision on these particular mechanics and these, you know, things that they wanted to incorporate, was highly, it was good. It just wasn't fully complete. And if it wasn't for, you know, the Hard Eight Times video, and a lot of people was not receiving the demo extremely well, you know, and yes, there are copies that are out there that a lot of people have. There are actually physical real life NBA Elite copies that are out there, and some people still have them. They're going to cost thousands of dollars, but they are a trophy to some. You know, if I would receive one, I would be actually happy. I've been trying to get one myself. However, I still have the demo, and it's just luck that I still have it. You know, well, it's still in my account where I can actually retrieve it. So, and I can actually play it. But just looking back at this, this was absolutely, when you're looking at this and then you're breaking it down, the vision, you know, the outlook and what they was thinking about at the time was absolutely, you know, was great. And I can't even hate on it because of that. So what I'm about to do is that I'm going to let y'all listen to the introduction of the Jordan introduction. So let's go ahead and get to some of the gameplay, and I'll be back with you momentarily, everyone. So just check out everything, all right? Take a day off.
Welcome to the Jordan Draft Showcase, where once again dreams can come true for so many young special basketball players. Jeff, this is the next great group of star players that we're going to see down the road battling each other to show how truly special they can be.
Well, just a great opportunity for us, Mike, to see these great players, and also for these guys to get to go head-to-head against great competition and see who's the best player. Because obviously after this, the next step is the NBA draft.
And you can see how they have their own individual skills and how they play in a team concept as well.
Exactly. All the star players where they were in high school, but now trying to make that jump into the NBA, they have to see how they could fit their games into a system and into a style of the team they're going to go to. So.
Now I know that looked absolutely beautiful, and the way that it looked, I didn't want to show gameplay on that because, you know, I want to get to the actual game so y'all can actually see it with the actual NBA teams. But the only teams that you could actually play at that time was the Lakers versus Celtics, and the LA Lakers was the champions. But what I want to display to everyone, I want to let everybody see, is some of the actual settings that was still incorporated. I can't use rosters because you couldn't get in there at the time. So I want everybody to just to take a look, you know. Now, this is what I want everybody to take a look at, because this is the only way that you could really see the gameplay controls. And as you see on offense, what is it that you see that was missed in the control aspect of the game? Well, they did not incorporate and did not, you know, put in a turbo button. They didn't put in an acceleration button. They did not put that in. They didn't put an aggressive button in the game for defense. They did not do any of this. But what they did do with this was that, and as you see, everything is incorporated with the right thumbstick. Everything. Now, this was the Elite format. If people, now just me personally, if people, now you can go to the alternate format as you see here, where you can go back to the classic NBA Live control aspect, but I'm going to stick on the Elite right now. But, you know, then you can go back to the alternate. But these two, you had two options with what you can do with your controls and what you can do with, you know, your controls. As you see, it still had the traditional, but there was no turbo. Okay, you see the ball screen, you see the pump fake. You also see that, and what they incorporated in here was that, you know, with the right thumbstick being the primary control, you know, a lot of people just couldn't grasp upon it, you know, that, you know, all like that. They just really couldn't. And it was something that bothered people with it. So they had the Elite controls. And as you see, you know, on offense, and then you got the, you know, you got the advances, and they show you all the controls, and as you're looking at the controls, so it was very it was in depth. It's just that they took something that was necessary in the game, and that was a turbo button, as you see the controls. So it was absolutely a great idea on the things that they put, but you know, you had to get used to those controls. And when you get to the alternate, when you get to the offensive, you know, there's another, I'm trying to think of what is the other one as we go along. On defense, now we're on defense. This is what I liked on the defensive end that a lot of people really did not know. Now, with the control aspect on defense, they actually responded. So when you went to put your hands up, as you see, you can put your hands up, the two hands up, you press down the right hold, you hold down the right left trigger, and you press up on the right thumbstick. You put your hands up. That means you go long and you go big as you look at the controls. And I like the way they incorporated things, like with the take charge. It's with the L trigger. You see what the defensive hob. That's where you cut your man off and anticipating him and which direction that you go. If you anticipate wrong, you can get yourself out of position. So everything that they wanted to do in the game was, everything was user-based, but also it was player-based as well on their abilities, because it was influenced by the DNA. And that's one thing that was significant about these controls. So what I'm going to do, I'm going to let y'all look at this gameplay, and y'all tell me in the comments, what is it that y'all actually heard and seen?
Gasol. To Bryant. Bynum. Shot clock reads two. Knocks down the jumper. And Derek Fisher with 7 points.
Good old-fashioned pick-and-roll basketball. Come off the pick, knock down the shot.
The Celtics with the control of the boards.
Puts it up. Deep corner shot.
And Paul Pierce with a nice play, sinking the three.
You give up offensive rebounds as a team, it sucks the life out of you.
Artest. Puts it down. Spectacular finish.
Two things you got to do defensively: contest and contain. That was a poor job of containing the penetration.
Pierce is looking to get free. To Allen. Lets it go. Bynum with the rebound. To Artest. It's out of bounds.
Down the stretch of a close game in the fourth quarter, you have to value every possession. You cannot turn it over. You've got to get off a shot attempt. This is inexcusable to turn the ball over late in the game.
You want to win a game? Well, play defense and take care of the basketball. This is a recipe for disaster. You got to take care of the basketball to close out ball.
Garnett puts it up. Jumper off the mark that time.
Ready.
His foot just touched the line, out of bounds, turnover.
This is just unnecessary right here. Careless with the lead, stepping out of bounds, uncalled for, unnecessary, untrustworthy, un-American.
Reaches in, taken away by Rondo. From downtown, oh, he puts it in. Big three from Paul Pierce.
That's running the offense to perfection, pushing the basketball and making a play. To Bynum. Gasol gets it off. Misses that one. To Pierce. Allen. Shot clock with 6 seconds remaining. Gets a good look. It's good. To Artest. Gasol. Thrown away. To Bryant, fires for three. Garnett the rebound. Critical possession right now. Pierce can't find a way through. Lets it fly. Gasol the rebound.
You got to figure out how you can get a better quality shot and use your greatness to attract the second defender and find the open man.
To Fisher. Bynum.
Shot clock to two. Jumper won't go. Rondo against Fisher. Fires away for two. Knocks it down. What a clutch play. Whistle blows. It'll be a quick timeout here. 20 seconds.
Hey, it doesn't look good, but you got to give yourself a chance to win. Last minute of the game, come out of the timeout, get a quick score or get yourself to the free throw line, and then try to knock the ball loose with your pressure defense.
Kicks it back out from way downtown. Artest jumper for three. Won't go. Whistle blows. Unintentional foul. No choice there. They had to stop the clock and they give the foul. And he connects on the first free throw. Rajon Rondo with 15 points. To Artest for three. Misses from downtown. To Allen. Blocked. Lets it go. Garnett against Gasol. Pierce from three-point land. Puts it in. He's in rhythm now. Fisher pulls up for the shot. To Allen. And that's the final buzzer. It's all over. There are NBA champions, and then there are those who lose in the finals. Jeff, this one might stay with this team for a long, long time. What a tough
Now, after watching that, that made me even more I want to play this game because there were a lot of things I was incorporating in this game because a lot of people didn't know how to play it. The thing that made it bad was that the things was not, the animations was just not fluid enough. They just wasn't. But you did see physicality. And you did see, you know, you saw all these things that were driven in this game. Now, the good thing about this game was that if you had to play it to really get the feel of the game, you saw signature shots. You saw, you know, signature movement. You saw certain things that were in Live 10. The atmosphere. You saw the crowd. They just dimmed it down. It wasn't as light full as it was in 10. And as you see the DNA rating, you're looking at it at the present moment. So you're seeing the DNA. You know, they do have the DNA rating. And again, like I said, they simplified everything from NBA Live 10 down to this. But people didn't even know that the DNA was actually incorporated in this game. It still has Synergy Sports. But like I said, the game came out, so a lot of people did not know. And the good thing about it, when you look at these ratings and you break it down so much from it, you see that when we get to the box score, when you see they had real life percentages, you actually will miss shots. You actually could block shots. You actually could play defense and cut people off. You had to anticipate on which hand that you had to do instead of spamming on the button to steal. Let's just say in an instance that a person trying to spam on the button, you switch hands and drive right by them. It's not influenced by a canned animation that you couldn't control. And this is the significance as y'all saw that box score and you see the stats. So let me go ahead and get out of this. But everyone, I'm going to go ahead and get ready to close this out. I hope everyone enjoyed this video in the vault. Gladly subscribe to the channel and hit me up on Twitter. Everything will be in the description box below. Gladly, if you have any questions, gladly. Or if you want to have a discussion, gladly. Put your comments down in the comment section and go from there. This is your boy Prime. If you know, you know. But if you didn't know, your boy Prime always going to keep bringing it to you when it comes down to the NBA Live franchise and what's the significance of this franchise and how important that it is. See you next time in another segment of The Vault, people. Y'all be blessed. Peace.